Hello, everybody. This is Alan Fine. I'm here today with Roberto Martinoli, who is the CEO of Silver Seas Cruises. This is not the first time. In fact, he's it was Silver Cloud, where James Schillinglaw, my partner, and Roberto last spoke. We're going to talk now about Silver Sea, and actually, there's a lot to talk about, and not just COVID-19. And this is Insider Travel Report. You are where? Are you in the office?
Yes, I am. We just came back to the office. So, as you know, I mean, we've been going into a lockdown 6 or 7 weeks ago. I lost track of it. And we have just started going back to the office this last Monday, by the way, in a very limited way. So we have like about 20 people over 150, but it's a good first sign of going back towards normalcy. And, you know, so far so good. I mean, you know, the things are coming together. We see that the virus is behaving. We are not having more cases. Cases are going down. And we are very happy to see that.
Well, that's good to hear. So let's talk about how is Silver Sea doing? Where are the ships and the crews?
Yes. We have ships that are in different places. They are all they are not operational, and we have two ships in Panama: the Silver Explorer and the Silver Muse. And they are in Panama because their next task would be to go to Alaska. So that's why Panama is where we have where we place them. They are a tanker over there, and we have had. We have one ship in Galapagos, of course, the Silver Galapagos. She is in Baltra, I mean, you know, at anchor, waiting to go back into service. We have two Galapagos ships, by the way, because the Silver Origin is almost ready for delivery. And I have to say that the yard is doing an excellent job. And even though with this pandemic situation, I mean, you know, they're very close to be ready to deliver the ship to us. So we are waiting in a minute, I mean, a call then to go to Holland, to Rotterdam, and take delivery of that one too. And then she'll move over to Galapagos, of course.
Right.
And then we have had four ships in Tenerife, where, I mean, you know, they have been grouping there the ships that were supposed to be going to, you know, operating in and around Europe. And we have actually five ships in Tenerife. Now we have then decided to move the Cloud and the Spirit. They went to Southampton because in Southampton we could get crew to London and fly them to their homes. That was possible. Unfortunately, we just learned today that the Philippines have closed the airports one more time, so we need to wait a little bit longer. But we
so
already sent
to get
quite
to
a number of people.
Yeah.
Yes. So, and
did you mention Silver Moon?
The Silver Moon is in the yard. We are waiting for the yard to tell us with the fate of the vessel. You're going to be hearing probably in the next week or so. I mean, about because delivery is becoming imminent, so needless to say that there is some risk of a delayed delivery there for sure. So, it depends on how quick the yard can go back into operation. Mm-hmm. So, we are waiting to hear from them any minute.
So how were you able to handle the layoffs and the furloughs? What percentage of them?
Well, I mean, we are not yet to skeleton crew. It depends because we are not being able to fly people back home. And also we had to reposition ships. I mean, you know, we had like as an example, the Muse was at sea for like 40 days from Australia to Panama. And the Spirit was at sea for almost 40 days from Australia to Tenerife and then London. And where we could fly people home, we did it. And, you know, we've been able to reduce, probably we are about 30-35% of the crew on board at least in this moment. If we were to go into an extended layup, which is probably the case, I mean, you know, to last... for at least another 30, 60 days or 75 days.
Wow.
We're going to be also going, probably you need between 40 and 60 people on a vessel. depending on where she is, if you are alongside or a tanker and everything. And we are also putting ships together. So we try to do smart things. So on one ship, we have people living on one ship, and that one ship fits the other. And mm-hmm. the people, I mean, they are moving from one ship to another. So mm-hmm. we are sharing resources. And
That's smart.
We have like a group of people, you know, every two ships that are handling all the necessities. I mean, of course, this is, it's a form of, we called it cold layup. In reality, it's not cold, because cold would be like shutting down everything, which we do not. And in that case, also, you want to make sure that all of your systems are your engines and pumps and chillers and whatever are started every so often.
Right, they don't freeze up on
that, yeah, exactly. So there is a number of things that you need to do to keep them up. And so you need a certain amount of people there.
I find that's so you've got them docked side by side.
Yes.
With the crews working two at once. That's very...
And we feed, we generate, power on one ship, and we feed the other ship with cables. So that, we try to optimize things. I mean, you know, we are all doing the same thing. We are all making sure that, to preserve as much liquidity as possible, because we want to make sure that we can, wait any length of time before things go back to normal. And although we all very much hope in a quick resolution of this, but we want to be conservative and make sure that we preserve resources so that there is no question that we will get to the point where we can have the entire fleet back into operation very successfully. Right.
Well, speaking about getting back to normal, we've been publishing the dates, but let's just go over what you are so far projecting.
Well, at the moment, we are about, mid-July is where we are thinking of, going back into operation. And every week, we look forward 4 or 5 weeks and we make decisions. I mean, that's the best way to do it, because you never know. I mean, as this thing came unexpected and abruptly, onto us, who knows, maybe we are going to be having also some good news one day that some form of a treatment, vaccine or antibody or whatever would become available.
Right.
And therefore, I think that, this is the right way to handle that. So it's uncharted waters for everybody. So we'll take it as it is.
Absolutely.
I have to say that also our clients, want to make sure that we don't cancel if it is not absolutely necessary. Because many, many people, they want to go back to cruising, no matter what. So
well, let's
we'll
talk
not
about
allow
the client.
Them to go back if it is not in the right condition. But there is a lot of very positive sentiment. And I would say that all expert cruisers, they can't wait to be back. They are not concerned at all. They know that we will do the right things to have them back in a safe and healthy way, and we will do so.
Let's talk about those clients. So you obviously had cancellations, you had rebookings, you have future cruise credits. Let's talk about the percentages and were the travel agents able to convert them from cancellations. Let's talk about that, please.
Yeah, of course, we try to have our guests stay with us, and we are giving those that when we cancel a cruise, we give 125% future cruise credit, and not only that, but also the travel agent is will make a commission out of it, will get a commission, and will make another commission when the future cruise credit will be converted. So this is certainly a very good deal for all of us. We want to keep our clients. We want our clients to have a good deal and stay with us. And we want the travel agents to be able to earn their commission in these difficult times. Well, they are difficult times for everybody. So we all need to share this and make sure that we do anything we can, to support each other.
What percentage would you say actually postponed rather than canceled, which would be a good sign?
There are different good signs. I mean, think of it. We have a little higher percentage. I'm hearing that in the mass market is about 50-50. For us, it's a little bit worse than that. But, I mean, when you look into the future cruise credit versus refund, it is pretty obvious that when you go to a higher price, people tend to want, in more people tend to want refund because, I mean, of course, it's more money. It's pretty, pretty, it's very obvious from that. Another interesting thing is that, I mean, counterintuitively, the older the client, the more they go for future cruise credit. You know, so this is a very interesting dynamic that we observe in our client population. And so that's a little bit what we are observing. And the other thing is that when we look into the new bookings, they are about 70% of those are new bookings. They are not voyage to voyage or future cruise credit reprotected. So which is a very good news for us, because that means that there is also interest from not only from people that are just rebooking, but also from people that really want to go cruising. So those are the addicted Silver Sea guests that we love.
What's travel going to be like? Well, let's be specific about Silver Seas. Yeah. What are some of the changes that the guests will start to see?
Well, I mean, most certainly, I mean, you know, we are going through this return to service procedure. And I mean, the number one thing is that we want to make sure that whoever goes on board is healthy. So we will have to go through some sort of testing.
Testing on the way aboard, right?
We have to. I mean, unless, as we said before, we wake up tomorrow morning with something great happening, which is most welcome, of course, if it does. But I mean, if not, I mean, you know, we really want to make sure that first the crew that is on board is absolutely 100%, healthy, and the same applies to our passengers. And so that's the first challenge that we need to face. There is a lot of, I've been reading, I don't know how many books about testing. I mean, I was not a very good student in chemistry, although I'm a naval architect, marine engineer, so technical matters normally would. For me, these things is like Arabic. I mean, you know, I don't understand it. But, I mean, you know, I've been building up a little bit of knowledge, of course, because I want to make sure that I understand what's going on. And there still is a lot of uncertainty about it. And, I mean, think of it. Governments cannot implement decent testing procedures yet. So we are there. We have hope. There are technologies that are coming out that are giving us very good hope. Easy test, very reliable, that anybody can do also at home. So we're waiting to see what's coming out to make sure that we can implement that.
Well, speaking of that, I know that Mark Conroy spoke with my partner, James Schillinglaw, and one of the innovative things I heard you thinking about, was maybe sending test kits to guests before they even arrive. That's really innovative.
It depends on what type of, maybe, I mean, that would be a little optimistic. You might still want to have someone to assist the guest doing the test. Actually, I did one of those tests today, and I'm negative. I didn't have it. I mean, you know.
Yay.
Actually, you would hope that you had it already, because, I mean, you know, that would mean that you are immune, but I didn't have it yet. So, anyway, those test kits are easy. They are accessible, but... I mean, we have not decided yet whether or not it's something that we would have people doing it on their own, or we would have some sort of...
Supervision might make the test more reliable.
Correct, yes. So that would be...
Still, it was a great idea.
Yeah, no, and there are ways. I mean, the one that I did it myself, but I mean, I'm not certifying anything. I'm not saying that with that test I can go to... safely, I mean, you know, into any environment, but anyway.
What should travel advisors be doing at this time? What should they be saying to clients to make them confident?
Well, I mean, you know, the first and foremost, I mean, my personal reading of this is that the speculation on cruising being like the multiplicator of the virus is a big misconception. And I think that, I mean, it's very safe to say that the level of hygiene and safety that there is on a ship, we don't find it anywhere else. And us being the expert, we know this very, very well. So, I mean, the moment you decide that you are going to go out, I mean, if you want to stay confined, of course, I mean, stay confined, you know, to go on a cruise ship is not a good idea if that is your goal. But the moment that you decide that confinement is not anymore the solution to this problem, I mean, I think that you want to be on a cruise ship.
Where's the next safest place? It might be a ship.
Absolutely, 100%. Because you have people with medical expertise, with big, I mean, we have procedures in place, we are used to it, we know how to handle it. We have, I mean, a lot of things that, I mean, resorts and, I mean, not to speak badly about other leisure activities, but they don't have anything near to what we have. So that's the number one. The second thing is that for sure, we are all very aware of what's going on. The moment we will go back into service is because we consider it to be safe and doable. And, you know, not only that, even if we wanted to do it, I mean, authorities and regulators will not allow to do it, us to do it. So we are very seriously looking into any aspect of cruising. And as we said, I mean, you know, embarkation, I mean, staggered embarkation, you don't have everybody coming at the same time. So you want to make sure that you get people, I mean, you know, coming with at different times.
Appointments to board the ship.
Appointments to board the ship. You know, like when you before boarding, there will be a number of additional tests and measures. You test your temperature, your level of oxygen, your heart rate. I mean, you know, all of these sort of things combined with the testing, if the testing will be the solution, because it will be considered to be needed. I mean, you know, so it's going to be a very different process. And life on board is going to be also a little different because we want to make sure that we will continue to maintain a reasonable physical distance. I like to call it physical distance rather than social distancing because, I mean, you go on a cruise ship and you don't want to lose the socializing that you have on a ship. But, I mean, you want to make sure that you give opportunity to people to have the physical distance that is required. So I would suspect that we will see most crew wearing masks and gloves. I don't think that passengers will be wearing masks and gloves unless you go to certain particular, if you go for a spa treatment or something like that, that's a different story because, right. I mean, you cannot maintain, I mean, the physical distance that is considered to be safe. And therefore, probably
those if a passenger felt more comfortable wearing a mask, it would obviously
that's
be allowable.
Fine. That's absolutely fine.
You should
fine.
Probably have a special social event with the masquerade party and the ball where everyone
absolutely. And I mean, you know, we all have masks off. you see, I can. Yeah, you match your T-shirt color, and I also right. have one. That can match my suit.
A new event on the ships.
So, by the way, I mean, probably mask will be more part of our life in the future. I mean, it's something that we've been seeing in Asia for a long time. And also the Western world will is likely to go down that way. So, I mean, in our case, we are a little more fortunate than average because our ships are a little different. It's a little bit easier for us being smaller, I mean, you know, to implement certain procedures. I mean, we don't have a real buffet lunch or breakfast, but we have we don't have a self-service, so we serve people. And we're going to be probably, you know, changing the way we do business in our dining rooms. So it's going to be a reservation, making sure it's going to be open for a more extended period of time. So instead of having, like, I don't know, like 7 to 10, it's going to be 6 to 11. And making, you know, we will have to make reservation to make sure that everything is properly organized. A table for 6 will become a table for 4. I mean, the table next to it will be a little bit more far away. I mean, you know, these type of things. Entertainment, the main theater, will be more shows with less people inside, again, to make sure that, you know, we guarantee the physical distancing that is necessary to make everybody feel comfortable. Swimming pool, you will have a little less chairs. I mean, you know, they will be taken a little bit more apart. I was suspected at the beginning we will not have any Whirlpool, I mean, working at any time. We have small casinos, I mean, you know, where, I mean, there is not much space. So we probably are going to be doing something, you know, with the casino is going to be probably tough to operate at the beginning. Certain spa treatments will be different or adapted or maybe postponed until better times are coming. But I mean, the important thing is that, you know, all of that needs to be making sure that, I mean, you know, the guest experience is comparable to what it was before. So this is the goal that we have in mind. I mean,
you know, and then this is for our travel advisors to now be able to say, these are the things that are being taken into account. This is why you can have confidence, especially since Silver Sea was already a luxury product that was already clean and pristine. And now they're doing this.
Yeah, you don't see, you never see much, you know, crowded places on our ship almost ever. I mean, probably the event that we are redesigning is the boat drill. I mean, you know, the boat drill at the beginning of the cruise. When you go to the master station altogether, we are looking into alternative ways of doing it, again, to make sure that to be respectful of the physical distancing while, you know, guaranteeing that the guests know exactly what they need to do in case of an emergency. And this is absolutely doable.
So is it going to be staggered like the shows?
It has to be. But at the end of the day, you need to know your, you know, how do you go from your cabin to the master station and where do you need to go? And then from the master station to your lifeboat, what are the emergency signals? I mean, you know, and get all the training. So, I mean, you don't have to do, I mean,
everyone. Well, that's the minimum.
I mean, you know, so you can do it in a staggered way. So that's probably the way we are all going to do it in this way. Yeah.
Well, let's talk now, please, about how is Silver Sea supporting the travel advisor in terms of training and being ready to, I mean, they should be already talking you guys up. Well, how are you supporting them?
Well, I mean, you know, we do as many webinars as we can, I mean, to support our travel agent community. I mean, of course, we went through a period of adaptation of working from home, although we had all the tools in place, and particularly, I mean, you know, because of, you know, all of us in the U.S., we have, like, offices that need to be guaranteeing business continuity in case of hurricanes and stuff like that. So, I mean, we had all the technicalities in place, but this has been, like, ongoing for a very long period of time. So we still have our sales force that are very close to the travel agent community. We are all actually, unfortunately, very busy in handling the huge amount of cancellation that we had to handle because we decided to idle and to cease operation. So that has been taking a lot of our time and a lot of our advisors' time. And I mean, what we are doing now, in addition to what was done before, we've also been reviewing our policies in terms of commission. And while before we were, you know, guaranteeing, you know, that we were not recalling commission to our travel agents, and we were paying commission for those that were, you know, getting a future cruise credit instead of a refund, we have now decided also to go for paying commission retroactively since the month of March when these things started. I mean, you know, to the travel agents that had the guests that decided to cancel and get a refund instead of a future cruise credit. So, I mean, we believe that this is a very important thing. We heard them. I mean, they've been writing to me. They've been writing to Mark Conroy, to Peter Shanks, to our, I mean, you know, like managing directors of the different commercial offices. We understand and we agreed that we were going to do it. I mean, you know, to give them the right support and help them, navigate through these very difficult times and make sure that we will all come back together when we will be flooded by bookings, because people, I'm sure that cruising will come back very, very fast. I mean, you know, we've seen it already a few times. It seems that the world is ending, but in reality, you know, when the right condition will happen, I'm sure that it's going to be a very fast comeback.
planning for that, let's tell the travel advisors any new promotions that you're pushing, things you want them to be aware of.
What we are doing at the moment, we are having this kind of a floating deposit. So you can book a cruise. You pay $1,000, and if within the end of June now, this is the first expiry of this promotion, you decide that you confirm the booking, the $1,000 is transformed in $1,000 discount plus $1,000 Shibor credit. So, and in addition to that, we still have the early, if you are within the limits of the early booking bonus that we have, so if you are paying in full your cruise, within a certain amount of time before the cruise departs, you get an additional 10% discount. So this is a pretty good promotion that is working quite well. And we see that 2021, even aside of that, is really coming back pretty well. I mean, you know, and after 7 or 8 weeks of total darkness, I mean, you know, we are seeing more than light at the end of the tunnel. So there is definitely confidence of, wanting to go cruising next year, a little less this year, of course, and for the obvious reason. And the other thing is that for any departure up to the end of the year, we allow people within 48 hours from the departure of the cruise to cancel and get a future cruise credit. So, if people are not feeling comfortable 2 days before, they say, I'm not sure, I don't feel comfortable on doing it, they can just call us and we will give them a future cruise credit that they can redeem, and they don't pay any penalty for that.
Well, but also, they could find that they have the virus 2 days before, so we don't want them on the ship.
Yeah, well, that's, in that case, of course, we would be happy to reimburse
them. Take the money.
And stay home. Yeah. I think that, of course, we all need to be, this is the world we are living in today. And I think that we need to treat, our clients and the ships the same way we treat our homes, our offices, and our families. So we want to make sure that we do anything we can to keep the virus out of where we are. And we need to make sure that the moment that we go, to the office or we open our homes to visitor or anything, we do it in the right way. We cannot allow ourselves to make any mistake here, and we don't want to make any mistake. It's not necessary to make a mistake. We want to make sure that when we do it right once and forever. So that's obviously, the goal that we have in mind, and I have to say that I was repeatedly on the phone with Richard Fain, and for us also is extremely important to be part of this big company. We are profiting of course their cooperation, expertise, and skills, and resources, to make sure that we do the right things. And Richard's direction are exactly that. We want to make sure that we do it and we do it right.
We're going out to over 100,000 travel advisors. Is there anything you want them to know at this time?
Well, I want them to know that we are obviously extremely committed, to the trade. For us, the future we are sharing, whatever is happening in the future is going to be shared by them and us. So we really strongly count on them. We are doing our best to give them the best tools to be able to sell Silver Sea as a first choice to the clients. I think that we've been showing in the last years that we are able to perform very well. Satisfaction of our customer is extremely high. We are very privileged, to be able to supply an incredible guest experience. And we need their help to support the incredible growth that we have in front of us. Because we have 5 new ships coming, and we are not scared at all by the virus. We are, of course, but we know this is temporary. So we all need to bear this in mind. This is not going to last forever. This is something that is only temporary here that we need to manage, with perfection to make sure that when we come out of it, we'll be stronger than before. Unfortunately, there will be casualties. I mean, not everybody will be able to go through this terrible happening, but those that will make it and will transition through this difficult time will be very privileged because they will have incredible opportunities. And we need to support 5 new ships, so we need all of them to be with us.
Well, I know that they will help, and I know that we'll all be successful together. We just got to stay the course. Thank you for speaking with us.
Great pleasure. Thank you very much for having me.
Can we maybe count on checking in with you next month and see how things are going?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Great pleasure.
All right. Well, thank you. This is Alan Fine, Insider Travel Report.